Local absentee voters begin casting their ballots for this year's polls. Blasts in Moldova leading to fears of a possible spillover of the war in Ukraine. And the World Health Organization warns against a global drop in COVID-19 testing amid the emergence of new variants. For joining us, for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. The local absentee voting for this year's election kicks off. We'll have our correspondent RG Cruz later with an update from the Comelec's Metro Manila office. But in the meantime, presidential candidate Vice President Lenny placed under Comelec control less than 2 weeks before the elections. The poll body placed Marawi City and seven other municipalities in Mindanao under its watch upon the recommendation of the police and the military. Marawi was ground zero of the five-month-long battle between government forces and the ISIS-linked nationwide minimum wage increase if he wins a seat at the Senate. Labog, who is the national chairperson of the Kilusang Mayo Uno, stressed the urgent need for a wage hike amid rising fuel and commodity prices.
It's really revolting that every time there's a crisis and every time we ask for an adjustment, we a deduction 100 since December of last year. And that's the real value of 537 in Metro Manila is just 437. And it's not really enough to put up with the pricing increase of prices and commodities.
The Supreme Court deals a final blow to petitions against the country's controversial anti-terrorism law. It upheld its own ruling last year, which kept the measure mostly intact. Details from Mike Navallo.
Supreme Court magistrates sealed the fate of the contested measure, except for two parts. First, a proviso under Section 4, which exempts exercises of civil and political rights, such as protests, from being considered acts of terrorism as long as they are not intended to cause death, serious physical harm, or endanger a person's life, or create serious risk to public safety. A second provision struck down is the second mode for designating terrorists under Section 25, which allows the Anti-Terrorism Council to adopt requests for designations by other countries or international bodies if they follow the criteria set by United Nations Security Council resolution. But petitioners wanted more provisions voided, such as Section 4 on the definition of terrorism, Section 9 on inciting to commit terrorism, Section 10, which punishes recruitment and membership in a terrorist organization, Section 12 on providing material support to terrorists, and Section 29 on warrantless arrest and extended period of detention. One closely contested provision is Section 25, which grants the Anti-Terrorism Council the power to designate terrorists on the basis of its own finding of probable cause, which could lead to freezing of assets. It barely passed scrutiny with a vote of 8-7, with Justice Carandang voting to declare the provision unconstitutional, but was outvoted. It is not immediately clear how her replacement, Justice Antonio Coe Jr., voted, as no breakdown was provided to the media. But according to the Supreme Court, Coe sided with the majority, while the other justices maintained their votes. A copy of the resolution has yet to be released. Malacanang welcomed the ruling, calling it a triumph for all peace-loving and law-abiding Filipinos, as it supposedly serves a stern warning that the Philippines is not a safe haven for terrorists. But the National Union of People's Lawyers, who acted as counsel for petitioner Bayan, says they are downhearted by the ruling. Although they remain optimistic, the law will be struck down, amended, or repealed ultimately. The Free Legal Assistance Group still maintains the vague definition of terrorism and the grant of broad powers to the Anti-Terrorism Council are dangerous, prone to abuse, and violative of the Constitution. Rights Group Alliance Karapatan warns the Supreme Court ruling will only engender commission of human rights violations, calling on candidates to take a stand on this issue and call for the junking of the anti-terror law. The denial of the motions with finality means the Supreme Court will no longer entertain additional arguments and pleadings on the issue. But the December ruling said it's possible to challenge the remaining provisions of the Anti-Terrorism Act once these are applied to specific cases. Mike Navallo, ABS-CBN News, Baguio City.
And our correspondent RG Cruz now joins us with an update on the kickoff of the three-day local absentee voting. RG, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. Good afternoon. Local absentee voting began in earnest Wednesday as registered voters took the opportunity to vote ahead because they will be on duty on Election Day, May 9. Members of the media voted at the Comelec Regional Election Director's Office at the National Capital Region other local absentee voters will vote at their respective offices. There are 84,357 registered voters in LAV, many of them from the Philippine Army, the Air Force, the Navy, the PNPD, the Department of Education, the COMELEC, the Department of Interior and Local Government, the Philippine Coast Guard, the Department of Foreign Affairs, Bureau of Fire Protection, Bureau of Geo Management and Penology, Philippine Military Academy, Culion Hospital, National Power Corporation, the Public Attorney's Office, and the media. Local absentee voters only vote for President, Vice President, Senators, and party list groups. Registered local absentee voters have to vote from April 27 to 29, from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., or else they won't be able to vote on May 9 as they have been marked as local absentee voters in their polling precincts. The LAV, Carmina, is done manually, which means voters have to write their preferences on a manual ballot instead of using the automated election system. There is an isolation polling place for those exhibiting COVID-19 symptoms at the time of the screening. Voters will also be temperature screened upon entry. And of course, we are at the COMELEC Session Hall now in preparation for the scheduled voting of Commissioner or of Chairman Saidamen Pangarungan and possibly other commissioners earlier this afternoon. Carmina?
All right, RJ, and the footage that you sent here to the newsroom, we saw you as one of those who actually availed of the local absentee voting days for members of the media. How was the experience like for you? Walk us through it.
Okay, we arrived before polling began because we were also going to cover it, of course. And then the polling began in earnest at 8 o'clock. We checked our names in the list outside the polling center. And when our names was in there, when we saw our names in the list there, we were temperature screened. And then we were allowed inside the polling center where we had to queue up again. And then we checked our names with the Board of Election Inspectors. And once I saw my name there, I was given my ballot and, of course, the envelopes and the seals. And I proceeded to the voting area where they already have a ballot secrecy folder as well as a list of the candidates from which you will choose your preferences. Mm-hmm. And then after filling out my ballot, which, of course, I had to do by longhand because it is not an automated ballot, I had to put my thumb mark on one of the stubs or on the stub at the bottom of the manual ballot, tear it up, and then put my ballot, my accomplished ballot, inside the small envelope, and then seal it with the paper seal, and then put it in a bigger envelope with the part or with the stub with my thumb mark, and then seal that envelope again with the paper seal, and then transfer it or drop it off at the yellow ballot box, which is of course a very familiar sight to all of us.
Yeah. So from beginning
the entire
to
process actually
yeah,
took
I was gonna ask
around
you that.
10 minutes.
10 minutes.
The entire process actually took around under 10 minutes for me, because I already had a código or a cheat sheet of my preferences. Of course, I had to switch out a name or two during the time of voting. But the entire process took under 10 minutes, excluding the time that we were queuing up outside because, we arrived early as we were also covering.
Mm-hmm. All right. Glad to know that it was a pleasant experience for you as you cast your vote there. RG, I also have to ask you about, you know, the various issues involving the COMELEC as of late, people not being able to find their names via the precinct finder. They have to troop to a local COMELEC office to check on that. Is that something that the COMELEC on back will also discuss today? Or if at all you know anything about how the commissioners and the on bank are going to address this matter?
Okay, Commissioner George Garcia has been in touch with the media insofar as the matter of the voter verifier is concerned, and he is aware of the feedback of the concerns with regards to voters not finding their names. There have been instances wherein the voters were not able to key in their names properly. Mm-hmm. So that there's that. And of course, he also reminded us that those who are having difficulties with the voter verifier, they will also, all voters will be receiving this voter information sheet before election day. It's going to be sent by snail mail. And it will contain your voter information. This is the voter, this is the official notification from the Commission on Elections to all registered voters about their voting information, specifically where they will vote on election day. So if you don't see your name in the voter verifier, you will see your name and your voting location in the voter information system.
If you get that. If you get the snail mail.
Get that. Yes. And they assure us that, it will be sent out and that they hope that the voters will get it.
All right. Our correspondent RJ Cruz there joining us live from the Comelec. Thanks, RJ, for joining us today. Really appreciate it. And back here in the newsroom, joining us now, correspondent Jervis Manahan. He's going to tell us all about Vice President Lenny Robredo's campaign sortie today in Bulacan. Jervis? Hey, Jervis.
Yes, Carmina, good afternoon. VP Lenny is set to return to the vote-rich province of Bulacan for the third time. Her first stop is here at the Star Arena in Baliwag, Bulacan for the Liniwanag sa Baliwag event before she proceeds to the grander and bigger Republica 2.0 Tindig ng Bulacanyo event in Malolos, Bulacan later this afternoon. Supporters are now arriving hours ahead of her scheduled event here. On her first visit in the province, she campaigned in San Jose del Monte, Giginto, and Malolos. On her second visit, she went to the historic Baraswain Church where she snagged the endorsement of incumbent and re-electionist Governor Daniel Fernando. Bulacan is the fifth most vote-rich province in the upcoming elections. A star-studded rally awaits as celebrities are joining the rally later tonight that also features a pyro-musical event and aerodrome shows. Meanwhile, Vice Presidential Candidate Kiko Pangilinan will have separate events in Malabon and Navotas. Earlier today, the tandem attended an interfaith prayer gathering online. Robredo said that even she wins or she loses, they will continue working for a better Philippines. The tandem will be barnstorming in other provinces in Luzon in the next days and will culminate their campaign run in a meeting de avance in Metro Manila. Carmina.
Right, Jervis, have you been able to talk to the people who have trooped early there to the venue? And can you tell us if they're there because they want to see the concert, as you mentioned, that's going to happen later tonight? Or are they there for the candidate and not the concert?
I'm sorry, Carmina, there's just some, it's very noisy here. But if I got your question right, if I had talked to some of the supporters, yes, I did, and they are very excited to see VP Lenny Robredo in flesh later this afternoon. And they will be proceeding, most of them will be proceeding to the bigger rally in Malolos after this event here in Baliwag.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan there joining us live from Bulacan. Jervis, thanks. Take care and keep safe. Concerns growing on a possible spillover of the war in Ukraine to neighboring Moldova. Kyiv has accused Moscow of trying to create unrest in a Russian-backed separatist region of Moldova. There were reported blasts in the region targeting the state security ministry and the military after a Russian commander claimed Russia supporters in Moldova were being oppressed. Some point out Moscow used the same argument to launch its invasion of Ukraine.
We are aware of the explosions that occurred yesterday in Transnistria. We're closely monitoring the situation as we determine what happened. We reiterate the Moldovan government's call for calm in response to these incidents. And we fully support, as you have heard us say before, Moldova's territorial integrity and sovereignty. We respect its constitutionally guaranteed neutrality. We don't know all of the details beyond regarding what transpired yesterday, but we do remain concerned about any potential attempts to escalate tensions.
As tensions escalate, the U.S. called a meeting of 40 countries in its airbase in Germany to discuss ways to help bolster Ukraine's defense. Among those in attendance are not just Washington's European allies, but other countries further east, like Japan and Australia, who fear that a Russian victory in Ukraine may set off a precedent and spur China's territorial ambitions.
To ensure that we continue to build on our progress, we're going to extend this forum beyond today. I'm proud to announce that today's gathering will become a monthly contact group on Ukraine's self-defense. And the contact group will be a vehicle for nations of goodwill to intensify our efforts and coordinate our assistance and focus on winning today's fight and the struggles to come.
Russian President Vladimir Putin tells visiting UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres he still hopes the conflict in Ukraine can end through negotiations. Despite the ongoing military operation, the Russian leader says an agreement via the diplomatic track remains a possibility. But Putin says the peace talks were derailed by claims of atrocities committed by Russian forces in Bucha. Guterres, meanwhile, reiterated his call for Moscow and Kyiv to work together with the UN to set up aid and evacuation corridors to help civilians in Ukraine.
I'm concerned about the repeated reports of violations of international humanitarian and human rights law and possible war crimes, and they require independent investigation for effective accountability. And we urgently need humanitarian corridors that are truly safe and effective and that are respected by all to evacuate civilians and deliver much needed assistance.
Russian energy giant Gazprom halts sending gas to Poland and Bulgaria. Poland's state gas company said all Gazprom deliveries to the country will be halted by Wednesday. Gazprom deliveries to Bulgaria will also be suspended by Wednesday, according to its energy ministry. The moves come after Russia said unfriendly countries must start paying for its gas in rubles or it would cut supplies. Both countries have refused this arrangement. Poland says the suspension is a breach of contract. Bulgaria, which relies on Gazprom for more than 90% of its gas supply, said it has taken steps to find alternative sources. Sweden looks to submit simultaneous membership applications to NATO together with Finland as early as mid-May. That's according to local media, citing Swedish government sources. According to the reports, the U.S. and British governments had promised Sweden of increased military presence and strong political support from NATO. Russia sees this possible NATO expansion as a red line that threatens its security. It has warned of serious military and political consequences if Finland and Sweden join the alliance. Finland has the longest border with Russia among European Union member countries. We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, the World Health Organization warns against a dramatic drop in COVID-19 testing. Details of that story and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC. The World Health Organization warns against a global drop in COVID-19 testing amid the emergence of new variants. Three-quarters of Beijing's 22 million people lined up for COVID-19 tests on Tuesday as authorities in the Chinese capital raced to stamp out an outbreak and avert a citywide lockdown that has shrouded Shanghai for months now. Beijing reported 33 new locally transmitted cases Tuesday, slightly higher than 19 community infections reported a day earlier. Beijing is acting swiftly compared to Shanghai, which waited for about a month and more than 1,000 cases before launching a citywide testing in early April. China's financial hub, meanwhile, reported 48 new deaths. Nearly 12,000 new COVID cases were also recorded in the city. Meanwhile, neighboring Hong Kong will push through with its plan to further relax social distancing measures in May as the COVID situation in the Chinese territory continues to improve. Hong Kong leader Carrie Lam says experts believe another surge in cases is unlikely because of the high level of hybrid immunity the city has already achieved. But Lam added, the government will not ease up on border controls or flight suspensions to prevent the importation of infections into Hong Kong. Words of encouragement, but also a warning coming from the World Health Organization on the ongoing pandemic. The WHO says global COVID cases and deaths have been dropping dramatically, with last week's 15,000 fatalities marking a new low since March 2020. But the chief of the WHO says while this is a welcome trend, the declining numbers could lead to further cuts in testing.
Last week, just over 15,000 deaths were reported to WHO, the lowest weekly total since March 2020. This is a very welcome trend, but it's one that we must welcome with some caution. As many countries reduce testing, WHO is receiving less and less information about transmission and sequencing. This makes us increasingly blind to patterns of transmission and evolution. But this virus won't go away just because countries stop looking for it. It's still spreading, it's still changing, and it's still killing.
The COVID-19 pandemic has officially caused more than 6 million deaths, but the true toll is believed to be at least three times higher. Here at home, Octa Research Fellow Dr. Guido David says the possible COVID resurgence in the Philippines may not be as high as the spike in cases seen in January. David says he sees around 5,000 to 10,000 daily cases if Omicron subvariants fuel a surge. That figure is nowhere near the almost 40,000 daily infections during the COVID wave at the start of the year.
Let's remember that this is still basically Omicron. These are sub-lineages of Omicron. And based on the data that we're seeing, the presentation is not that much different from Omicron, and the characteristics are not that much different, which means that most cases will most likely be mild, and that's why we're not super concerned that this will trigger a major threat of an outbreak. We have to remind our kababayans na even though this will likely be mild for vaccinated people, it may not be mild necessarily for unvaccinated people or those with comorbidities.
Well, in the wake of that warning, President Rodrigo Duterte again urged the public to follow health protocols.
In COVID-19, is nandyan pa. So kindly remember that for all time. That it is there, it is here with us for all time also. The only way that we can get rid of it sa ating, I do not care about the other nations, bayan natin is we have a concerted effort, cooperate with government sa mga sinasabi namin kung ano ang mabuti, the things that we advise the people to follow, we can only interdict the surge of in the future by the simple of washing of the hands, ang mask, importante talaga yan.
And joining us now to discuss the WHO's warning on the huge drop in COVID-19 testing around the world is Dr. Ronchin Salante. He is the head of the Adult Infectious Diseases and Tropical Medicine Unit at the San Lazaro Hospital. Dr. Salante, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us. Welcome to the program.
Yes, good afternoon, Carmina.
All right, so numbers are going down, but testing, that's down as well. What to you is a clear and real COVID situation here in the country as we speak, Dr. Salante?
Well, the COVID-19 cases are really low at this point in time. The healthcare utilization is more or less very low, and the positivity rate is low, so that's normal. Testing also dropped. No? And that is expected. Your cases are low, and people only have mild symptoms. Why will they test? They will be paying a lot, and they only have mild symptoms. after 3-4 days, they are okay. So that is expected. Testing will really drop because of the lower number of cases.
But even if it drops, it doesn't mean that you do not know the real COVID situation, because you have other parameters that you can look at as well.
The most important parameter that we are monitoring now is always the healthcare utilization. Always the number of patients who are coming to the hospital because of severe infection, because of severe COVID. The number of cases that are positive and are mostly are mild, that will not really be an important part now of our monitoring. In a way, they will have to shift into targeted testing. Testing those vulnerable who have symptoms, because these are the people that are higher risk of getting the severe form of the infection. Unlike in the past, Carmina, when you have the Delta, everyone has this fear that if they have COVID, they will die. No? But at this point in time, people will say, I have COVID. I know it's less virulent. I only have mild symptoms. Why will I test? Mm. So that's, again, the mentality of the people. And more, the other impact there, the cases are going down. Mm.
But do you think that we should resume to ramp up testing, or is this a good scenario for you?
For me, this is a good scenario, because even if we ramp up testing like we did when we have the Delta, I don't think people are already encouraged to do the test, no? And as I mentioned, even those people who have mild symptoms, they will just stay at home, they will just rest, and the belief that it will just go away and it's because it's mild, there's no motivation for them to do the test, because they believe this infection is only mild and they will not be in the hospital because of this.
And especially because they've been vaccinated and boosted as well.
Well, yes, that's one factor. But again, we have to be concrete about the information that the primary vaccine series that we receive is not protective anymore with the Omicron variant. And that's why we are encouraging everyone to get the booster to maintain that level of protection against Omicron.
Okay, we're going to talk about the booster shots in a bit. But first, you know, we talked about the scenario as far as COVID patients are concerned. But we got to talk about what's causing the illness. We got to talk about how the virus itself is evolving. Very interesting point that the chief of the WHO said earlier, that experts are sort of blind now because the sequencing and the testing, that's not happening as it should be happening at this point. Does that concern you, doctor?
Yes, very important, Carmina, because like now, there are variants of concern, some variants that are already in other countries like India, China, and even South Africa. Now, if we don't test, what will the Philippine Genome Center do for the sequencing? We don't have any idea what's the variant that is causing the infection here in the Philippines. And that's the reason why we will be blinded on, are we having those variants of concern? What is the current status? What is the more accurate number of cases that we have now? So these are the important elements that the takeaways that when we are dipping down testing, then that's also the consequence.
Mm. So then how do you strike a balance? Because as you said a while ago, this is a good enough scenario that we're in right now. There are low COVID cases and people are experiencing mild symptoms, and therefore they just want to ride it out and not test anymore. But then you also say that it's important for testing to still happen so we can track the evolution of this virus through sequencing. So what's the balance that we're looking at here? Where should we be at?
Well, that's so difficult now, because even if I'm going to correlate this with vaccination, people are already having this COVID fatigue. They don't want to go for the booster. If they have symptoms, they don't want to be tested. And I think one of the important aspects of testing is they are paying it. No? And in other countries, they are not paying it. They are being given free. So anytime you have symptoms, they will go to your house, they will be tested. And that's, I think, an important aspect when we are testing, because money is the drawback for those who wants to be tested.
I mean, here we are so far into the pandemic, Dr. Solante, and we're still talking about free testing. What does that tell you?
The importance of having tests to be free is everyone can have access to it. Everyone is encouraged to get the test, like in the workplace or even in areas where you will be required to do the test. No? But it also entails formulation of policies. Like, for example, if you are working, we are not anymore requiring, because of the alert level one, we are not anymore requiring people to be regularly tested, only for those who have symptoms. But again, because of a mild symptoms, how can you encourage them? They want to work, and at times, even if they have symptoms, they work. And that's, I think, where the problem is.
Mm. How concerned are you about the emergence of sub-variants of the virus entering our shores, our borders, Dr. Silande?
It's really a concern, because if you look at the data from South Africa, when they already have the BA2, and when they have now the B4 and the B5, which is also highly transmissible, it causes a spike of cases there. In India, it's also the same. Okay, so this is something that's very critical for us to really monitor these sub-variants, because this is still an Omicron, but more highly transmissible than the original Omicron variant, and can be a possible source of the spike and surge of cases in the coming days.
And that's why it's all the more important now to get that booster shot, Dr. Silande.
Precisely, and I think people should always be given this information that the primary vaccine series is not enough for us to be protected against Omicron variant. We are still in the Omicron era of this pandemic, which is highly transmissible, which also affect the immunity of our vaccine. That's why a booster is the best protection that we have. And of course, the health protocol we should maintain also.
How do you, you know, go over that hurdle of COVID fatigue?
Yeah, I saw a lot of these patients, when you mentioned about COVID, they shy away. And, you know, I think it's normal for people to really be on this stage of the pandemic, okay? We just have to support them and just have to give them the information. Foremost of which is, if you have symptoms and if you are in the vulnerable population, you have to have the test, because we know that these people are higher risk for severe infection. For the general population, the younger population, if they have symptoms, we still encourage them to do the test, because if we know that they have COVID, they can be isolated and they are less vulnerable to transmit them to their family members that are the vulnerable population.
Yeah, so it's still the same. Do you think that government has been communicating this message across effectively?
I think there is more than enough communication. And I think it's just that at this point in time, people are keep on hearing this and so routine, and they have other things to be prioritized with their work and the other things that's happening now, the election. They are prioritizing this. So a lot of these things has been a factor why the focus is not more on the COVID, but for other things.
Yeah, so what do we do? Do we just sit down and wait for the surge in numbers to happen?
I hope that will not happen, because again, we have learned our lesson, and we keep on repeating this scenario of a cycle of decreased poor compliance to the health protocol. Then we have a new variant, increased transmission surge, and then booster vaccination is encouraged. That's always the cycle of the strategy that we have been observing the past year.
All right. So Okta Research Group also saying that if our borders remain open and the sub-variants, I should say, find their way to our shores, then they're seeing cases of between 5,000 to 10,000 daily because of the sub-variants. Is that the same analysis that you have, Dr. Silande?
Yes, that's why border control is critical at this point in time, or when we don't have yet this sub-variants, because past experience has taught us that with Omicron, it was able to penetrate the Philippines and it causes surge. Now we now have a more transmissible sub-variant, and people from outside were carrying it, was able to bring it here. We have the potential, there's a possibility that we can have also the search. But what I would like to probably emphasize here is that we are more in a better position now compared to the previous years, no? Because of our vaccination rate. We continue to advocate booster, and of course, the availability now of more effective antiviral agents, Carmina.
Mm-hmm. But as you know, Dr. Solante, as a final question, the tourism industry is in dire need as well of, you know, of a boost, for lack of a better term, at this point. They're opening up. The industry is opening up. People have been coming, whether it's local tourism or international tourism, and the numbers are showing that the economy is slowly waking up because of that. But then you have this reality of emerging subvariants and the possibility of those subvariants entering our shores. So again, we look at a healthy balance here. What could that be?
It's difficult to get that particular balance, Carmina, because the priority now is really opening up, recovery from the economy. And if we have to deal with another surge, then I would say let's just have to be prepared for it.
All right. And as you say that, are you confident that the healthcare system, as we speak right now, from, you know, from the time the Delta variant entered our shores, that you really are better off and you can handle any kind of surge this time around?
Yes, I think so. And even with this Omicron variant, we see that this is the less virulent variant, causing less death. So I would say that it may not be able to overwhelm our healthcare utilization compared to what we experienced with Delta.
All right, so things are looking up, but we're not out of the woods just yet. Dr. Ronjin Solante there joining us this afternoon. Thanks a lot. Take care. Keep safe.
Thanks, Carmina.
That is Dr. Ronjin Solante, infectious diseases expert. We're going to take another break now. Still ahead, the Miami Heat advance to the second round of the NBA playoffs. This is Dateline Philippines. We'll be right back. Have improved in terms of sustainability. Tourism Secretary Bernadette Romulo Puyat adds government aims to preserve tourist attractions in the country by protecting the environment, citing Boracay's six-month closure in 2018 for rehabilitation.
Kaya talaga we received a lot of awards from all over the world because talagang they were very impressed that we closed our top tourist destination because we wanted yung regenerative tourism na. We want sustainable tourism and we want a tourist destination to be even better than it was before nga, yung mas maganda pa, yung hindi nasisira at nakikinabang yung kalikasan, hindi nasisira ang kalikasan, and it also benefits the host communities.
Secretary Puyat also says the Philippines recorded more than 300,000 foreign tourist arrivals in the past 3 months as the country reopened its borders to leisure travelers. Most of them were from the U.S., Canada, and South Korea.
First, pagdating sa accommodation establishments, mga hotels, mga resorts, kahit mabuhay accommodation, we are very strict na dapat sumusunod sa health and safety guidelines na ginawa ng Department of Tourism together with the Department of Health. At in fact, we had the WTTC Safe Travel Stamp. Ibig sabihin, our standards are world standards. We are very strict. Ang maganda ngayon sa social media, kung nyari may lumalabag dito, agad namin nakikita na chicheck. Mm-hmm. If lumabag, we give a show cause order. At kung umulit, pinapasara natin. Mm-hmm. So, yun, we're very strict with regard to mga hotel, mga accommodation establishments. But it's very important to work with the LGUs.
The cabin crew of Philippine Airlines will no longer wear personal protective equipment during flights. The flag carrier says its cabin crew will now go back to wearing their regular uniforms amid decreasing COVID cases and the increasing number of fully vaccinated individuals globally. But the warrant makes that the wearing of masks and gloves is still required. The decision to revert to the standard crew uniform is also based on the alert level and regulations imposed by the country's coronavirus task force. The Philippines and Japan sign a new 30 billion yen, make that 30 billion yen or 12 billion peso COVID loan. The finance department says the agreement is the second phase of Japan's COVID-19 assistance. The Philippines will use the loan to support the country's economic recovery from the pandemic. The first tranche of the deal, worth 50 billion yen or 20.5 billion pesos, was signed by the two countries in July 2021. The finance department also unveiled the Subic Bay Regional Development Master Plan, which was finalized with the assistance of the Japan International Cooperation Agency. The master plan will serve as a blueprint to maximize the economic development potentials of Subic Bay and surrounding areas. The finance department says the plan covers development projects in the road network for Olongapo's Central Business District, logistics terminals such as the Alava Wharf, as well as public utilities. In sports, the Miami Heat have advanced to the second round of the NBA playoffs. The top seed of the Eastern Conference eliminated the Atlanta Hawks with a 97-94 squeaker in Game 5. Miami won despite missing two starters, forward Jimmy Butler and point guard Kyle Lowry. Seldom used Victor Oladipo, picked up the slack for the Heat with 23 points, while Bam Adebayo added 20. The Heat will next face the winner of the Philadelphia-Toronto series. Over in Memphis, the Grizzlies are now up 3-2 in their series against the Minnesota Timberwolves, thanks to their superstar Ja Morant. The newly crowned Most Improved Player awardee sank a huge three-pointer, then converted the game-winning layup with a second left to give the Grizzlies a 111-109 victory in Game 5. Morant's heroics allowed Memphis to overcome an 11-point deficit in the fourth quarter. The T-Wolves will try to even the series in Game 6 at home. A stern warning from the European Union to Twitter's new owner, billionaire entrepreneur Elon Musk. The EU says Twitter will have to comply with Europe's new laws curbing the power of big tech. The warning comes after Musk vowed to take a robust free speech stance on the platform. This has raised concerns Twitter will become a host for hate and propaganda. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the News Channel.
To be better for demand, if we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.